Well, morning. Thank you for coming. And this talk is about how to introduce microservice and serverless architectures in Python projects in general. I will try to explain each one with practical examples and for decide whether microservice or serverless architecture operations are well suited for your architecture or not. Basically, we start with a couple of definitions, what are microservices and serverless, and some examples. And this is the main points I'm going to talk. I will talk about microservices in Python, what are the frameworks and the tools that we have in Python for building applications following this type of architectures. Later, I will introduce basically serverless, what are serverless and functions as a service, the main points of this type of architecture. Later, I will comment what are the main Python frameworks for working, for example, with Amazon Web Services from Python. And I will center into tools that I will comment, like Zappa and Chalice. And finally, I will try to show some demos for deploying AWS Lambda functions from Amazon console. Well, this is a graphical view from Google Trends where we can see the evolution of both terms. Basically, microservices are at this moment over serverless, but the term serverless began to be known more at the beginning on 2017, and basically nowadays microservice is a more used term than serverless, but in the next years maybe serverless architecture, serverless topics will increase, can equal even put of a microservice. This is the evolution with, I think that serverless in the next years can equal or put over microservice in the next years. Well, when we are talking about microservice, basically a microservice architecture puts each functionality into a separate service and scale by distributing this service across servers. Microservice architecture exists when your system is divided in small responsibility blocks and those blocks doesn't know each other. They only have a common point of communication, generally a message keyword. We can, in Python, for example, we can find some tools like Celery, Redis, RabbitMQ, for example, for developing our architecture with microservices. In general, if you are building microservice in Python, for example, we have these two frameworks, Tornado and Twisted. Basically, these two frameworks are very useful when you're when you increase the number of concurrent requests, and it's important that these requests are calling in a synchronous mode, and these two frameworks are very useful for when you have a very a lot of concurrent requests and you have each request in a specific process on a specific thread. In a synchronous way, you can use these frameworks. With Python also, we have a classical, very known async IO and an HTTP, for example. In microservice architectures, asynchronous calls play a fundamental role when a process used to be performed in a single application. No implicates several microservices. Asynchronous calls can be as simple as separate a thread or process within a microservice-based application. In this example, we are using async IO and HTTP as the main model for doing these tasks in our application. In Python, also we have we can find frameworks like Flash or Django-based frameworks. These frameworks basically are oriented to developing our REST APIs and communication system based on HTTP, which is perfect with for building our microservice architecture. These two frameworks are the most known in Python ecosystem for create web projects. In my opinion, if we have to select one of these between Lean and Flux, I think that the best option is Flux, maybe because it fits perfectly with the principle of unique responsibility in microservice architecture. Flux also allows to be more all-terrain. For example, if you want to create an API management or working with a non-relational database or other systems like GraphQL, and now I will comment this kind of architecture with GraphQL. And for example, for the performance point of view, there are some studies that say that Flash turn out to consume 8% less memory and have 6% response time faster than Django. And in this task, and from the performance point of view, in terms of memory, CPU and response time, Flash has a better performance than Django. We are developing our architecture thinking in this kind of tool. We must keep in mind that when we talk about microservice, it's usually accompanied by a greater consumption of memory and resources, and the performance is important to study this aspect in our application. Another type of architecture we find in microservice is the use of GraphQL. GraphQL brings a microservice arrangement such as data owners separation, granular data control, parallel execution, and service coaching. Another benefit of adopting GraphQL is the fact that you can fundamentally assert greater control over the data loading process. Because the process for data loaders goes into its own on point, you can control in a granular way how data is transferred. And GraphQL provides, in this aspect, a good solution for doing this kind of applications. Also, we can combine the combination of GraphQL with Python. Basically, it's designed to replace REST API we can build with Flash or Django REST framework. We can use the combination with GraphQL with Python. What are the frameworks that we can use? For example, GraphQL is a library for building GraphQL APIs in Python in an easy way, and it can integrate with applications based in Django, Flash, or an SQL Alchemy, for example. Basically, GraphQL, for example, allows you to define your models, define the attributes in your model, and also pairs queries to get the data for those particular models. In the same way that we have the Django ORM, for example, we can use GraphQL to define our models and schemas and interact with a data phase, whether relational or not relational. Another type of architecture that we can build with microservice, for example, is using the combination of Django and Celery. For example, Django can emit many tags. For if we have an architecture with we can use, for example, Redis or RabbitMQ as message broker. And Celery basically what provides is an asynchronous distributed task kiwi. And we can pass the message to the application. Celery is a good solution for real-time operation also, but supports scheduling as well. And as a comment, it's useful for Celery is very useful for background task processing, and you can communicate with Django through the message broker like Redis or RabbitMQ. Another solution that we can use in Python is using the use of zero MEQ. Zero MEQ provides building blocks to develop a scalable distributed system on top of sockets. Basically, we can build, for example, a simple publish subscribe microservice. For example, with zero MEQ and Flash, we can build in a simple way this kind of architecture. For example, this can be our server, our zero MEQ server or publisher. In this example, the response of service call is published as a message. We have a message, and the message will publish in the socket that provides zero MEQ. And later, our client will read the message from this socket, and the application will respond to that message. And this is the client part where this can be our zero MEQ client or subscriber. In this example, we have a class Zeta client that we have the init method where the constructor where we initialize the host, the port, and the context for subscribe the client. And basically, the Zeta client is subscribed to the channel where the server is sending message. And when the server sends a message, the client responds, calling with the receive message and connecting to the subscriber topic. Well, in general, the idea with microservice, the idea is break the monolithic architecture and separate each relevant functionality in a specific component. Microservice also helps software team stay agile and improve incrementally. In simple terms, as the services are decoupled from each other, it's very easy to upgrade and improve service without causing the other to go down. Microservice also can be much better leveraged via containers, for example, with Docker. We are working with Docker or Kubernetes solutions, where, for example, microservice are a very useful solution because provides an effective, a complete virtual operating system environments, process isolation, and so on. Well, now I'm commenting the serverless part. The serverless, I will start with a definition. This is the definition that we can find in Wikipedia, I think. Basically, serverless computing is the practice of building and running service and applications without having to worry about provisioning and management servers. Basically, what we are doing is the code is running in executing environments that are managed by cloud providers such as Amazon, Google, Microsoft, and so on. With serverless, you can deploy your code in the cloud without worrying about instance. Capacity basically is automatically managed by the cloud provider in a completely transparent way by the developer. Well, serverless architecture, the serverless architecture that I'm going to comment is based on function as a service. Function as a service means that every serverless model that you are programming has a function. And this function is executed on the cloud. Basically provides features like scalability, provisioning, deploying, all these things that you normally are executing in your local machine. You can use these cloud providers for executing this command. And another feature is that you only pay for the time your code is running in the server cloud provider. Serverless computing, basically, the best feature that has is that allow us to focus on building the application without managing infrastructure. And what provides to the developer is the developer's focus in the outputs, the inputs of the Lambda function, and the logic in between. And the rest of the different structures, servers, memory, CPU, the rest is all managed by the cloud provider. You only need to focus in the important of application, the logical of your applications, and the inputs and the outputs. In general, serverless functions, these are use cases. For example, we can build REST APIs in the same way that we can build with Flash or Django REST framework. We can also use this kind of architecture for building chatbots. For events, also it depends the cloud provider. For example, Amazon provides the S3 event for file processing, data ingestion. It's very useful this kind of architecture for data and stream processing. IoT projects, incident handling, because for example, Amazon provides a CloudWatch event log, and another time of tasks related with scheduled tasks like monitoring, load attentive, and periodical. All these are use cases that we can find in serverless for managing the projects. In general, later I will comment what are the drawbacks of serverless, but in general, serverless functions are well suited to operations that take a very short time to complete and no resource intensive. Why? Because cloud providers normally impose execute on time and memory limits, and which mean that if the workload is a long running process, a conventional server model may be more appropriate than using the instead of using a serverless solution, we need to use a conventional server because our process, our thread or our application exceeds the time and memory limits imposed by the cloud provider. This is another example that provides, for example, with Amazon. This is an example for processing and serving multimedia with AWS architecture. This is popularized by Amazon. Basically, it's an image processing event handling function. This is our function, and the function is connected to a data store such as Amazon S3 that emits change event, and each time a new image file is uploaded to a folder in S3, an event is generated and forwarded to the event handling function that generates a thumbnail image that is stored in another folder. And in that way, we can see that each time a client uploads a multimedia to the S3, the S3 is the data storage of Amazon, and each time a client upload a multimedia to this data storage, the process is executed. If the multimedia event is a video, the Lambda function is responsible to calling, for example, Elastic Transcoder Service. This is the service that use Amazon internally for converting processing video and so on. And if we have an image, then we call the Amazon, the other service that has Amazon for these tags. And basically, all this graph is our function. And depending the events that produce, it calls one side or another. The benefits that provides serverless solution, basically you don't have to worry about clusters, load balancing, You lower infrastructure costs, as I commented before, by developing a serverless system. The infrastructure costs can be greatly optimized, as there wouldn't not be a need for servers to be running permanently, and the server starts whenever the function is triggered or event is produced, and stop whenever the function gets executed successfully. And the drawbacks. Also, we have a little drawbacks. For example, drawbacks related with debugging, deploying, and monitoring. Deploying and monitoring, for example, the behavior of multiple functions maybe can be more complicated than monitoring a microservice, for example. In this kind of architecture, for debugging, for example, we have a good support in general. There is a good support for in most tools. I'm going to comment later. Most tools include visualize logs in different developer environments. For example, in Amazon we have CloudWatch logs for getting metrics, monitoring, and debugging. There are many tools, but it can be better in the future. And another drawback that we have is that the tools around the development automation of serverless. There are many developments, but many of these tools are still in development, adding features, and so on. And another drawback is we have no control over the containers because what are doing these cloud providers when you have a Lambda function in a cloud provider, internally it creates a container for executing the code and so on. And we have no control over this execution environment in the containers. This is the regarding the cloud providers. The most known maybe can be Amazon, because it has a lot of service. One of I'm commenting now is the Lambda service. Also we have Google Cloud Platform and Microsoft Azure. And for open source solutions we have Apache OpenWiz and QLS. QLS is a serverless framework for Kubernetes. If we work with Kubernetes, we can use QLS for a serverless framework for doing these tasks. And OpenWiz is an open source project for IBM. It basically provides native support for many languages and supports other many languages and runtime via Docker containers. These two frameworks are designed to be deployed over, for example, if we are working with Docker, we can deploy over Docker Swarm or Kubernetes clusters. And they offer a serverless open source environment where we can execute our code. And they support many languages like Java, Python, Node, PHP, and so on. And at this point, I am going to center now in the Lambda service for Amazon. Lambda is the main AWS service dedicated to serverless computing. It is integrated with the rest of Amazon service, like the API Gateway, DynamoDB, Notification Service, S3, and so on. It's a service, basically, it's a service that allows you to write Python code that gets executed in response to events, like HTTP requests, or, for example, when we upload to a file to Amazon storage, we can write our functions for responding to the events like this. What is the basically with Amazon? We have two types of calls. Two approximations. When we are programming with Amazon, we have two approximations. The synchronous, that implies that we have a REST API, and through the API gateway we invoke Lambda functions behind the API. We have the classical request response. And the other approximation for working with Lambdas is the asynchronous way that implies that there is a Lambda function that is listening to events. For example, with a file, it should load to a storage bucket in Amazon, or when we get a notification in Amazon notification service. And when it's produced this action, then it's called the Lambda function. Lambda function are equivalent to salary workers. If we know this kind of architecture, if we have worked with salary, Lambda function is the equivalent. The idea with Lambda functions is that they can be triggered asynchronously via some AWS events. Basically, the benefit of running a Lambda function is that you don't have to deploy a salary microservice that needs to run 24/7 to be message from a Kiwi. A Lambda function basically is a handler function that Amazon can invoke when the service executes your code. And this is the basical syntax, the general syntax structure when creating a handler function in Python. We have as parameter the event and the context. The event is the parameter for passing data to the handler. This parameter is usually a Python dictionary type. And the context is this parameter provides the runtime information to your handler function. And the return value of this function can be anything, from bashing values to dictionaries converted to JSON string, for example. How we can create this function in Amazon? For example, with the AWS CLI command, from this client, with this client, we can create a Lambda function. Basically, we provide the region of our account in Amazon, and the zip file with our code, our role, the runtime with the Python version that we are executing, and other parameters related with memory and timeout. And what that is, and this equivalent to, if we go to our console in Amazon, this is the web interface that provides Amazon to creating a Lambda function. Basically, we can deploy our Lambda function loading a zip file, and from the configuration point of view, the most important is obviously specify the runtime with Python, the Python version, and the handler function. What are the main frameworks that we have in Python? Well, for simplify the development process of Lambda functions, there are some frameworks and tools released from developing and managing your Python serverless applications. I will focus in two main, SAP and Chalice, but there are many others like Serverless, Lambify, and Python Lambda. Basically, when we are working with Lambda functions, it's important to know the Amazon API Gateway. This service lets you define an API that is full managed by Amazon. and provides offers a variety of ways to control access your APIs. For example, the serverless framework. This is a framework that is built in JavaScript and requires Node.js. You can install it via npm and so on, and provides boiler templates for creating our projects. Well, I'm going to start now with Zappa. Zappa basically is a framework that in an easy way you can deploy your Python applications with AWS Lambda and IP Gateway. With Zappa, each request is given its own virtual HTTP server, and it communicates with the Amazon AP Gateway for doing this control. Basically, you can communicate. Basically, it creates a virtual server in the cloud, and it executes and it creates an API in Amazon AP Gateway. Basically, for working with Zappa, Zappa provides a command line tool for Lambda functions, and for developing, for deploying, for working, for example, with Flash and Django, it has a lot of features. In this example, we can see that in an easy way with Zappa init command. This tool provides an interactive wizard that helps you to set up Zappa projects quickly when you are first getting started. The command line tool asks you a simple questions. For example, it detects if you are working with Flash or Django projects. It has the capacity to detect automatically this feature. And the execution of this command asks you about the configuration environments, if you are working in develop, stage or productions, and other variables like your main Lambda function. And in a simple command, you can deploy, update, or destroy an application for a specified stage, that is the develop, staging, or production. Once you create your projects, you manage the configuration directly in the Zappa settings file. Basically, this is a simple JSON that stores your project configuration for each stage, and it returns information about region execution, runtime execution, and application settings. Basically, when you deploy Zappa automatically, it creates the package, load the file to Amazon data storage, creates and manages the necessary policies and roles and the users, and register all information in the API gateway. This is an example where we can see that with Zappa, if we create, basically we need a virtual M. And this is the hello world from Zappa, where we can execute with the simple command, Zappa deploy and deployment. Automatically, package upload, creating the IP gateway routes and deploying the IP gateway, and you have the URL where the service is working. Also, another interesting feature that provides Zappa is that offers the possibility to execute functions in a synchronous way. In this example, you, for example, you have a Flask API to make an order. You can call a function in a completely separate Lambda instance by using the SAPA syntax decorator. And you can schedule your Lambda functions in the same way that you can configure your salary workers. This is the equivalent to configure the a salary worker, for example. And the last solution that I'm going to comment is the Chalice. Chalice is a micro framework for managing the Lambda functions and the AP gateway. In the same way that we have seen with SAPA, Chalice provides a command line tool for creating, deploying, and managing your app. The project is available in PyPI. You can install with pinInstall and available in GitHub. Basically, provides Chalice enables a single page HTTP handling, and you can use Python decorators, for example, the root decorator that automatically builds a routing table for the Lambda function to invoke functions based on the request path and method. In this example, for example, we are declaring our a function with the uproot weather and pass a parameter the city for obtaining the weather. For example, we can build our REST API in a easy way with Chalice. For example, if we have a classical REST API for getting, creating, updating, or deleting objects, in this case, for task, for tall object, the code is very simply. For example, we only need to annotate the function with the decorator root and specifying with the method. In the method parameter, we define we want to get a post, a delete, or a port. And basically, for doing this task, we can use, for example, in this case, we are getting the torch for a database in memory, for example. For update, we need also the ID of the tab. In below, we can see that we pass the ID parameter for modify the tab information. And we can see that in a nice way we can develop our REST API and deploying automatically in this case in us. Chalice provides many options. This is the options that provides. We can deploy our application in local, in localhost. We can create a new project. We can generate policies. And this is basically what this does. Chalice, when we made a Chalice deploy, Chalice internally update the Lambda functions, send the change to Lambda, the API with REST API already found, and deploy in the environment. And finally, if we want to test this kind of solutions in our machine, with Docker for example, we have a collection of containers for testing AWS Lambda environment. In particular, we have the Docker Lambda image. Basically, it's a sandbox local environment that replicates the live AWS Lambda environment almost identically, including software, libraries, environment variables, context, objects, and behaviors. And finally, for commenting the cost that supposed the using this service, we have the service serverless call. It's basically a calculator cost calculator, where we introduce the number of executions, the estimated execution, the memory, if we include a free type, because Amazon includes a free type for testing this kind of service, and depending what are the input of this of memory and so on, it reduces the cost, the possible cross cost of using this service. And you can compare what is the most cheaper solution for making a prevision of your project, for example. For learning this time of architecture, we have most examples. Amazon provides blueprints. Blueprints are examples that are configured, that are pre-configured. Basically, are configured templates for learning this kind of architectures. And in the serverless GitHub, we have most examples for learning this kind of solutions. We can find how to program our Telegram bot, for example, in Amazon, develop our HTTP, our API, our REST API with DynamoDB, for example, that is a database for Amazon. And finally, these are the references for making the tool. And that's all. These are for conclusions. Basically, serverless architecture. Using serverless, we can improve microservice architecture, eliminating the need to have the service always active. Serverless provides many advantages. And the use of serverless computing maybe is increasing in the next years. And that's all. Thank you.
We have time for maybe one question.
Okay, regarding this kind of architectures, what I have found with my team is that we had an issue with external dependencies, because usually when you are in Amazon or you are in Google Cloud, when you depend on third-party libraries that sometimes are compiled, they really deny you to install. Do you have this issue at some point, or?
An issue relating with third libraries dependencies.
Third-party libraries. So when you get into this architecture, what you are doing, pure Python, are you able to import third-party libraries? Because my team has been always in trouble with this.
I have no been trouble with third-party, but
I mean some PyPy compiled modules or whatever.
Yeah, PyPy. Yeah, you can install whatever library that you need. If the dependencies is in PyPy, there will be no
problem. It's
problems.
Automatic, so it takes the requirements. For us in Google Cloud, it failed. It basically failed. So that's what I mean. Okay. And how easy is to remove from this kind of architecture and to return if you say it's a mistake?
For remove,
this
project provide the command tool.
Yeah, for example, for getting out from Amazon and moving to another provider, or just moving into your own architecture, on your own server.
You need to run our on-premise on your servers, yeah.
All right, I'm afraid we don't have time for any more questions. Let's give another big round of applause to Jose.